Thank you all for joining once again this study that we do once a week. On other occasions, we have done question and answer studies where those who are participating with me live will ask me questions about any topic related to the scriptures, and then I will answer from my perspective of the Dead Sea Scroll faith. On other occasions, though, when people don't have as many questions to ask, I just pick a random topic. Hold on one second. Hey!
Andy, finally!
Alright, good to have you. Yeah, it's all right. Hold on one second. Do you guys have questions for us, or will you be asking me questions? Do you think, or are you just gonna be listening to what I have to say this time? All right. So, do you think? I think you have to turn off your audio on your side. All right. Okay. Hopefully you can still hear me, Barbara. If you can, just type in the message box through Skype. One second. Alright guys, I'm back. I was just setting up Barbara so that she could participate with us. So she is now with us, and she's listening in through Skype. She has her side muted for the audio. So some people already asked, or not necessarily asked questions, but they presented certain topics of interest for discussion and teaching for this particular one. And I'm going to start off with that. I don't know if I'm going to be able to teach on that the entire time, but that's something we'll start with. And when I start with that, that might compel you guys to ask other questions about certain things I share on these topics. So the main topics that were discussed or suggested were, there was one about, so far there was let's see here, there is one about cosmic geography, and there is how do you convert to become an Essene, and the difference between Essene and Nazarene. So those are all good ones. I'm going to be going to done with now. And I'm going to start. The first one is, what is the difference between an Essene and Nazarene? Basically, in ancient times, there was not so much of a difference, but because in modern times, people are trying to resurrect old beliefs or old systems. They are calling themselves a certain group, even if their beliefs are not in line with the ancient version of that group. So you've got Nazarenes today, but I can tell you it's most likely the case that those Nazarenes are very different from the ancient Nazarenes in terms of all the theology, all the beliefs. There might be some similarities, important similarities, but there's also probably major differences. And why? Because a lack of Nazarene documents preserved, and then just a big gap in history where you don't have that religion preserved. So you're trying to restore something on almost no basis, just on what your own beliefs are. That's problematic for restoring a group. So the Nazarene today, the Nazarene movement of people who try to keep the Torah or the Law of Moses, it is very open-ended. It's not really, the parameters are not neatly set. You can have Pharisees, part of that. You can have, you know, all kinds of different Jewish groups who identify as Nazarene. And the reason is Nazarene basically means, you know, the follower of the Yeshua, the Messiah, but also the belief that the law of Moses is still for today. And we're still supposed to obey the commandments of Moses. That's a very key part of the Nazarene concept. Other than that idea, there's no real limitation to what Nazarene is. You've got so many differences. So that's a key thing right there. And then the Essenes, on the other hand, they're very narrow, specific. These are our beliefs. If you don't agree with us, you're not an Essene. That's a very specific, you know, alignment. If you don't hold to certain key tenets, then you're clearly not an Essene. That's the basic idea. But there, of course, you know, with all groups, there's going to be some variation. Even if it's considered incorrect or false teaching or even a sin, you can still be in a scene and have a sinful belief or a wrong belief. But there are certain key essences, key aspects of the faith which define something as the Essene faith and define something as not an Essene faith. So, that's the main difference. And then in ancient times, according to the church fathers, we are told that all believers of the Messiah, Yeshua, were called Nazarenes, whether they be Christians. Well, you know, I don't really take too much issue with the term Christian, but what I mean is Christians who don't follow the law of Moses, who believe that is passed away, the Gentiles don't have to keep the commandments of the Torah. Even those people in ancient times were called Nazarenes in the very ancient time. But over time, the church stopped using that term and label Nazarene, and they started exclusively using the label of Christian to define their religion. And so in the later centuries, they would refer to Christians or believers of the Messiah who kept the law of Moses still as Nazarenes. That's the main definition. So, but the Essenes, not all the Essenes were followers of the Messiah, because the Essenes came before. But many of them, I believe, accepted him, Yeshua, as the Messiah and followed him. But so the Essene movement is the Judaism, religion of the Jews or Israelites, prior to when the Messiah came. Whereas the Nazarenes, it is my belief that the Nazarene movement was actually started by the Messiah himself, by Yeshua. And in my understanding, the Nazarene is a branch or denomination within the Essene group. That's what it originated as. So the Nazarene started out as an Essene denomination, a reformed Essene, so that, you know, you have the regular Essene group, then you have the reformed version. The Messiah came and reformed it. He added some things, maybe altered some things slightly, and so there came that branch that came off the main Essene, and then the other Essenes who were not followers of the Messiah, they were not Nazarenes, they continued following in their path without accepting Yeshua as the one who was foretold to come. And then there's a question of the Nazarite vow that Josh asks, and he asks, is that in the temple scroll, and could you elaborate on that some? Obviously, I have a basic understanding. Okay, so yeah, the Nazarite vow, as we know, is mentioned in the Book of Numbers. It's voluntary. If you want to take a vow, a special vow to make yourself holy, it gives you permission on how to do it in the Law of Moses. The temple scroll that was found, what we have there, gives us the ability to know that the author of that, who I believe was Moses himself, intended for all the laws of Moses, every law, to be in one compact book. So the laws of Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, all of that to just be in the complete set. And then even more, new laws, everything. So it's very likely that the Nazarite vow was covered in the temple scroll. However, the copies that we have, where it's not preserved there. On the temple scroll, on every page, or you know, not page, but every column, the top is completely missing. Many lines on the top. You're usually missing 10 lines very often, or more sometimes. But then there are other places which are much better preserved, and you're only missing about 5 lines. So it's very likely that there was a section about the Nazarite vow, but that is not preserved. And also the beginning of the temple scroll and the end of the temple scroll is completely missing. So how much longer could this scroll have gone? It could have gone on significantly longer and talked about other laws. But if you were studying the text and seeing how do we reconstruct what this original scroll, the form of it most likely was, we have a pretty good idea that there was something about the Nazarite vows there. Because there's something in this temple scroll which is about vows, which is not in our copies of Deuteronomy, it's an extra thing, and which is found in the book of Numbers. And that's vows for a woman who is married and who is the daughter who is, you know, living in her father's household. If she makes a vow, the father or the husband can annul her vow. That law is from the book of Numbers, and it's found in the temple scroll. But it's not found in our Deuteronomy copies. So basically, if we have the extra vow laws from Numbers in temple scroll there, it is very likely we would also have that for the Nazarite vow in another place that has not been preserved in our copy that was found in the scrolls. So hopefully that answers that question. Now, there was the question of how do you convert to become an Essene? So, Josephus gives some information about that. He basically interviewed and studied about and with the Essenes in the first century to learn what they believed and taught. So he wrote books about the history of the Jews, and in those books, he wrote about their beliefs, and some of their beliefs he wrote about discussed how they became, like how their conversion process happened. And when the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, the Dead Sea Scrolls match very well what the Josephus said about the conversion process. So we've got those two sources, and then we've also got we also have. We also have the apostles' teachings too. If you believe the apostles are Essenes, then you can take what they say as further evidence for what the conversion process. And I believe there's some good evidence that they were Essenes. So I'm going to go a little through with how to become an Essene conversion process. Basically, one of the main things to know is there's a 3-year conversion process. It's going to take you 3 years to become a full Essene. The apostles, on the other hand, in their writings, they actually say it takes 3 years to fully convert. But then they say, here's a little extra thing that's not in the Dead Sea Scrolls, but it's what the apostles say. And I agree with the apostles. So the apostles say, however, if a person is advancing very well, and has the ability and free time, you know, to learn so much in a small amount of time, if they're beyond their most people's ability, and it doesn't take 3 years, then don't require 3 years. Let them convert as soon as they possible. Because it's not the amount of time, but it's the quality, they say. That's what the apostles said. So we see the apostles are agreeing with the 3-year requirement, but they're saying that slight little exception clause. However, we do not absolutely say it is 100% necessary for a 3-year conversion process, but that's going to be the default. That's the default for everyone, that we're going to require everyone. But for those who show themselves exceptional in their ability to learn and accept the truth, you can come right on in pretty quickly. But so you have to basically, you study about the main beliefs of the Essenes, or, the apostles, their main beliefs. And when you look at all their beliefs, you see, am I going to accept these things? Am I going to join myself to their community? Am I going to abide by their rules? If you are, and you go through that process, and the leaders there judge your sincerity, then they will accept you as part of the community. And basically, one of the biggest concepts of the Essene faith is communism teaching. And we've seen this in the Apostles' writings and in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And that is basically, if you become an Essene, you have to basically make a pledge, an oath, to share your everything you have with all other Essene believers. The idea, so basically, in my perspective, since I identify as an Essene, if any of you guys were to become an Essene in the future, then because we are that bond, that unity, I am obligated to help take care of you in any way I can, and to share my resources with you, and you guys are to share resources with me. So the idea of helping each other in a community, that's a key aspect for the conversion of the Essenes. John is here. Thank you for coming, John. We are going through some of the questions that people were asking, and I'm answering them now. I was just answering a question about how to convert to become an Essene, and I mentioned that there's a 3-year conversion process, but that it's not 3 years is not required for everyone, but that's the default. So the apostles and the Dead Sea Scrolls, they had a default requirement of study with us for 3 years, and after that time, then you can join with us. However, there was that exception clause of that the apostles gave us, and that was, if you are exceptional in ability to learn, then, and if you don't need 3 years to convert, then you can convert much quicker. So the default is 3 years, but it's all based on people's ability and their how much time they have and the quality of their development. So there's that, and then the basic Essene concept is, as I was saying to the others, communism, where we, those who are our brothers who agree with the Essene way of life, we basically say to ourselves that because they're our Essene brother, we need to help take care of them so that we are to share everything we have with them, and they're to share everything we have with us. So just to give an example, as I said, I identify as the Essene. For someone else who identifies as Essene and, all the main viewpoints, if I have a job, which I don't currently, but if I were to have a job, and my brother does not have a job, and the person who doesn't have a job, it's not their fault, but they would like to have a job, but they don't have the ability, or they may be disabled or something, all these different possibilities. Then as a brother, I am obligated to take care of them. And then even then, if they don't need my help, I should still be sharing with them what I have. So, let's say it works much better when you're close to one another. When you're far away, it's very hard to help each other. But the closer you are, the easier it is. And when we're really close, like if someone was to say, if they were to say, let me think of an example. Let's say I have a car, which again, I don't have a car, but let's say I do, and you know they need a ride somewhere. I should be sharing my car with them. I don't necessarily have to give them my car, but I can devote my time to help them as we're family. So I should be doing everything I can to help my family, sharing all my resources. You know, time is limited, so you can't help everybody, but you do the best you can with those who are your family. So that's a key thing of conversion to the Essene. If you're not willing to sacrifice everything and give everything you have away to others, then that's not part of. Then you're not fully an Essene. The basic idea is, like, okay, so I have so many books right now. I have a laptop. I have clothes, things like that. So when I say you have to give everything away, I don't mean you have to. Like, let's say you have a house. I don't mean you have to sell your house right now. But you have to. Everything you have, you need to share with others. You know, if someone's on the streets, homeless person, you know, take them in, help them out. You know, all this different stuff. If you are able to help someone, share with them. Because, like, the land you have, it's not your land. It might say it's your land on a deed. But in reality, the land belongs to God. And I might have to sell my land in the future, but I bought land many years ago specifically for the purpose of building a community for people. And so basically my idea was, if I ever have a community one day, this land will be for everybody to use. Anyone who wants to come, they can live there for free, you know, and that's the idea, sharing with others. What's mine is yours. So my land is there. Come there. Join me as a community and we can have a society together. Instead, you know, other people might say, well, no, I'm not just going to let you stay on my land. It's my land. I paid for it. If you want to stay there, you're going to have to pay, you know, you're going to have to pay me something for rent or something. In my mind, no. Why would I charge you guys rent? If you're willing to be a part of the community, by all means, come. I'm not gonna require you to pay a rent to stay. You know, just try to help each other. Try to help us have a society together. That's what it's all about. So that's my ultimate hope, that one day there can be a lot of people who are Essenes who want to join a community together. Right now, that's not an option. No one wants to do that currently. But that's a key thing of the Essene concept. And as I mentioned earlier, one of the things for the conversion process is the leaders have to approve your conversion. But let me just say this. The ultimate approver of your conversion is God himself. So even if you were rejected by Essene leaders who felt that your conversion wasn't sufficient, that does not necessarily mean that they were correct in their judgment. The ultimate judgment is from God. So and you don't necessarily have to be fully converted to the Essene to be saved either, because if you're following the basic requirements for salvation from what you're able to do at the time, the knowledge that has been given to you, your abilities, even if you haven't finished your 3-year period of learning and studying, as long as you're obeying everything that you're accountable to at the time that you are called to, then you will be saved. If you are sinless and obeying God's commandments, if you die at that time, you'll be okay. So, you know, you don't have to complete your conversion process. You just have to be a righteous person. Even if you're in the beginning of your conversion process, as long as you're righteous and obeying everything that God requires of you, that you know of and that you're accountable to at the time, you'll be okay. But if you aren't doing certain things that you're accountable to already, and you're disobeying and sinning, if you're to die during that time, then something very bad probably will happen. Unless you're given a second chance during the millennium. That might be for some people. But otherwise, it could be very bad, the punishment. So you basically, you try to, as you're converting, make sure you're righteous to what you're able to know in your situation. And he tries to, I believe God judges based on your heart. So he sees if you're obeying all the light that has been given to you. And if you're obeying the light that has been given to you, then you will be saved, even if you're not fully Essene yet. Even if you're part of the Christian church, like the Catholics or certain groups, you've never heard of an Essene before, if you're a Muslim, certain things like that. If you've obeyed all the light that's been given to you, that you had access to, if you perfectly obeyed that, then you'll be okay. If, however, you rejected some of that light that was given to you, then that's where you're going to get into danger for your soul, is if you're not following the light that God has given you. Because we have to be realistic, and most people didn't know about the Essenes for the majority of all of history, ever since they came into existence, that is, ever since the time of the Messiah. Very few knew about the Essenes, and those that did, they didn't have a lot of evidence connecting the Essenes to the apostles. And a lot of these people didn't have the Book of Enoch, the Book of Jubilees, the Dead Sea Scrolls. So we have to understand that, yet there is the absolute truth, the standard, which I believe was the Essene way, but God is merciful, and he understands, and he's not an evil judge. He doesn't judge people for what's impossible to do. He judges them based on accountability and abilities, of mental abilities and physical abilities. A retarded person's not going to be judged the same way you and I are. So he's a fair judge. And so not just sort of keep in mind, some people who are not Essenes, who don't identify as Essenes, are going to be saved. But I believe a vast majority are not, because of how much corruption and sin has polluted people in the world. But otherwise, if I were to say only an Essene who follows everything that the Essenes taught and accepts everything they believed, then that's very unrealistic and doesn't really capture history very well. And doesn't make a lot of sense, because the Essenes, you know, they only came onto the scene, the Essenes came onto the scene about, you know, like 100, 200 years prior to the Messiahs. So we can't say absolutely only Essenes will enter the kingdom of heaven, but it's the Essene way is the only way. And some people will walk on that way without realizing it's the Essene way, but they will be walking on that way. So that's basically how you become an Essene. You just try to follow the Dead Sea Scrolls, follow the Apostles' teachings, and the Apocrypha. Try to follow those, and learn from the people who are already part of that faith. Learn what they have to say, study with them, and basically just follow what the scriptures say. And if you accept the Essene scriptures, then you're probably going to be an Essene, because the Essene scriptures will basically ultimately lead you to their religion. And so, you know, there's more too involved in the process, like ritual and the exact way of doing it for the 3 years. Like during the first year, you have to do certain things, and during the second year, you have to do certain things, and then the third year too. So there's different things like that. Baptism is an important aspect for the Essenes as well as the apostles, as we all know, the apostles taught baptism. So baptism for conversion, that is. So the The baptism is a key thing, repentance, but you don't have to get baptized immediately. You want to make sure that your baptism is done when you're ready to become one. Because if you baptize yourself and then walk away, you do much more damage to your soul than you otherwise would have. So you want to make sure when you choose to be baptized, if you haven't yet, that you are fully ready to become a believer of this of the faith. And this applies not just to the Essenes, but in general. Like, let's say you are being baptized into the Catholic Church. The same principle of if you're gonna be baptized into that, then you should really be making sure. You shouldn't be baptizing and then then renouncing it, and then baptizing into another group and then renouncing that. Basically, you want to make sure you're being baptized by the right people and into the right faith. So that's the main overview of that. And then there was one. And whose name do you baptize in? It's interesting because someone asked me that the other day or the other week. I can't remember who asked that, but basically, according to various apocrypha writings of the apostles, the name you baptize in is Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, as we know in the Book of Acts, we've gotten in the name of Jesus, or Yeshua, the name of the Messiah, and so some people think that that name is the one we need to use. But from my studies, I'm highly confident in the threefold formula of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, because we see that so many in different apocryphal writings, some of which are Nazarene documents, have this baptizing in that name. So the way I see it is, what is the name of Jesus, Yeshua? What's the name? What's the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? The name is Yahuwah, Yahweh, the Tetragrammaton. And so that name is my understanding that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, they're all Yahuwah, from what I've studied in the scriptures. It's one God, or one Elohim anyway. They're not all equal, though. The Father is the Most High, the Son is not. And Father's God Almighty, the Son's not, in my understanding. But they're all Yahuwah, they're all Elohim. And so instead of saying, I baptize you in Yahweh, Yahweh, and Yahweh, because there's the three aspects, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that would be silly to say that. So, and likewise, if you just say, I baptize in the name of Yahuwah, then it doesn't, while it covers all of them, it doesn't, it's basically, I think the main thing is the apostles wanted to emphasize the involvement of each of them, as well as the distinction of each of them, but as well as the unity of them, because other groups would want to baptize in the Father only, or the Son only, or the Holy Spirit only, or they thought that there was no difference, and so they were making a theological statement of we need to do it in this way. So I trust these documents a lot. So a lot of people have difficulties with some of the certain ideas, which some people might think is related to the Catholic Church or whatnot, but for me, I'll accept it. Even if it's similar to the Church, the Catholic Church, I don't care, because I have a good strong faith in the scriptures that I accept. So even if there's going to be controversial stuff in there, I'm going to accept it. As long as I can reconcile it and I can't prove it's false, I'll go with it. If I can reconcile it in a way that's not silly and ridiculous, then I'll try to reconcile it. So in other words, if you've got a two options open, like let's say you have a sentence of scripture, you could interpret it one way, A, or you could interpret it a different way, B. Both interpretations are possible. They make sense. Both of them make sense with the context. But one of them contradicts other things scripture says, whereas the other one does not. If they're both possible options, both valid interpretations that fit the context equally, I'll go with the one that fits with the scriptures, that it's not contradicting. Now, if you have an issue of an instance of where one of the options is the only one that doesn't contradict the other scriptures, and yet it's the only one that fits the context, then you have to be honest and say, well, you know, it seems to be the original reading, or at least in our current version, what the passage is saying. And I can't just twist it ridiculous like that to make it say something it's clearly not saying. So we got to be careful. We don't want to do that either. But so for me, I accept this, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit baptismal formula, because so many of these different writings endorse it, including ones that speak of the law of Moses. And, oh, yeah, John, it's okay. I decided to do it an hour earlier. My apologies. I wanted to put it a little bit earlier, to give some people a chance, if it was too late for others, because some people in the past have said that it was too late for them. So I thought I'd experiment and put it back an hour. I apologize for the mix-up there. In future, I'm going to try to do it at 8 o'clock instead of 9 from now on. But we might change it again. So just keep in mind of possible change of time. And I try to announce the time in my events. So just look at the event that for the study that's coming. Look at the event time, and I should have the time listed there for when I'm planning to do it. But I'll try to do it 8 p.m. My time zone from now on. And there was asked, hold on, there was, would I be able to baptize myself and my wife, or do I need someone ordained? Basically, the default position of the extra, you know, the secret scriptures is that someone ordained or a priest is supposed to baptize the person. However, we have an apocryphal writing, the Acts of Paul, which give us an instance of a woman baptizing herself, Thecla. She baptized herself. There wasn't anyone available to baptize her. And the church, the Catholic Church, has a teaching that basically says if... it gives a specification. I don't remember the exact rules of the Catholic Church because I'm not a Catholic. But they say something like a person who's not ordained can baptize someone in an emergency or something. I don't remember the exact thing. So I would say it's probably okay to baptize yourself if you don't have anyone available. But it may be the case, I'm not quite certain on this, but I would say if you baptize yourself now, you might have to get baptized again later in the future by an ordained person. But I'm not sure about that. So it's possible that, you know, because you don't have any ordained person that's legitimate available to you, then your baptism will be valid. So I don't see necessarily any harm in it to baptize yourself and your wife. It would be better if you baptized yourself and then your wife after. But here's what the apocryphal writings say, that you are supposed to fast one day minimum one day before you get baptized, it has to be, you have to fast from food and water completely for a day at least, and then you baptize. So let's see here. The thing is, Laura, like, the scriptures speak, the apostles' secret scriptures speak about being baptized into a heretical Christian group, or they don't say Christian group, but, you know, a heretical group who's teaching a different gospel or a different way. If you're baptized into their group, they basically say your baptism is not legitimate. We're not acknowledging that. You need to get baptized again. So the question is, was your baptism legitimate in who you were baptized into, by who you were baptized by? That's a very valid thing to look into and assess for yourself. I don't take so much issue necessarily with being baptized into Jesus, like the name Jesus. A lot of people believe that is a pagan name. From my perspective, from my study, I'm very much learned in language. I'm a very language-focused person, and so I know a lot of what I'm talking about in these language issues, and I can say that a lot of what people are saying in the Messianic movement and the Nazarene group about various words being pagan are simply not true. So my position is that Jesus is not the correct pronunciation, and that it is a really bad attempt at rendering his name how it was pronounced. Over time, it just got corrupt. Like, so for instance, in Italian, I'm starting to try to learn a little bit of Italian, but I'm being really slow at it and putting it off. But in Italian, his name is spelled G-E-S-U. And they pronounce his... they pronounce it as Jesu. So, you know, it's like over time, these names are, you know, they change based on where people are and the dialects. Obviously, his name doesn't change, but over time, language gets corrupted. It just is inevitable. So you have... So, you know, a lot of people make a big deal out of, like, Jesus, the ending, us, they connect with Zeus, right? Well, there you don't have that for Italian. You don't have Italian, you have, in Italian, you have Gesù. You don't have Jesus. So can you make that argument against the Italian, the Gesù? It wouldn't be connected to Zeus, it would just be an incorrect pronunciation. What I've seen is just we try to pronounce his name from what you're able to know. It's very likely that you're wrong, because most people, I think, are completely wrong about the Hebrew pronunciation of everything. But you try your best based on what you know. And I recommend, don't condemn people for a false pronunciation or a pronunciation that you believe is false. Here's why. Because we were told, how you judge others, you're going to be judged. So if you're condemning people and saying, you're going to go to hell for using this. Like, some people say, like, you know, Yeshua. You're saying Yeshua and you're sinning. You shouldn't say Yeshua. You should say Yahushua, because that's the real name. You know, things like that. We've seen some of that type of clashing. And those people who say that, if they're wrong, well, then they're going to be judged just how they were judging. They're going to be considered a sinner, because they were considering those people a sinner. Even though they were both wrong with the pronunciation, they're going to be judged worse, because they were looking down on their brother and saying he's a sinner when he's not, when you're guilty of the same thing, of wrong pronunciation. So I just urge you, don't worry about other people's pronunciation. Worry about yourself and think, I'm going to pronounce it based on I believe. But if you don't, unless you have absolute proof that that's how his name is supposed to be pronounced, don't go around trying to tell people they're sinning for how they pronounce it. I don't think that's righteous to do that. And I am very strongly convinced that the Hebrew, of my understanding of how Hebrew pronunciation works in the original Hebrew. But the problem is, in the first century, the Hebrew they were speaking was not the original Hebrew. So that makes it complicated. Was the Messiah's name in the original Hebrew pronunciation? Or was it in one of those dialects? Was it in this dialect? Was it in this dialect? Or maybe another dialect we don't even know about? How did they pronounce his name in that time? How was it spelled? Because there's differences in manuscripts of, does it spell it with a wa there, or maybe there's a wa there, or maybe there's not. There are differences which basically, to me, make it almost completely impossible to know how to pronounce the Messiah's name correctly. There can be guesses. I can give you my guess of how it was pronounced, but I can't tell you that is how it was pronounced. I believe I can do that for the Father's name, or, you know, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Yahuwah. I don't pronounce it as Yahuwah. I say Yahweh. Very similar to Yahweh, or Yahweh. But I say Yahweh. But so anyways, you have these differences of pronunciation. I'm not going to condemn you guys for pronouncing differently. I mean, people have difficulty speaking. They have speaking problems. Do you think someone who stutters, there are some people who have trouble with their R's or L's, or they stutter, you know? So I think we have to be fair in how we judge others. And I wouldn't, my take on this is, I don't think, let's say you were from a group that was obeying the law of Moses as best as they understood, you know, trying to follow the faith. We're well righteous, not entirely righteous, but, you know, they had a lot of good ideas. But they baptized in the name of Jesus. In my view, you don't have to get rebaptized. I just consider that an incorrect pronunciation. I don't consider that a heretical pronunciation. I don't consider Jesus to be a heretical pronunciation. Just a wrong one. And if you know about it, when you're talking to me, don't use it. If you know it's wrong, we know it's wrong. Let's not use it together. But my take on this is, you know, if you're talking to people who that's all they know, I think it would be a valid thing to use that from what they know and worry about the name later, because you are still saying his name, just not the correct pronunciation. But it's the name in their language as they understand it. So, you know, you try to reach them where they are, and it's kind of like talking with someone in their language. You know, someone doesn't know Hebrew. Why are you talking to them in Hebrew? They're not gonna understand that. Talk to them in their language. English, if they speak English, they speak Italian. Talk to them in Italian, because they're not gonna know what you're talking about. You know, Moses, that's not his name. That's a Greek. That's from Greek, Moses. But then the name Moses himself, that name is from Egyptian. Not even a Hebrew name. It's an Egyptian name, Moses. Not Moses, but however you pronounce it. I pronounce it as Musa. Others pronounce it as Moshe. That name is Egyptian. It's not Hebrew. So, that's what the scriptures tell us anyway. And so, we shouldn't make too big a deal about these name things, because if you're going to make a big deal about it, then you better be consistent. You better stop saying Moses to people. You better stop saying all these different ones. But if you do that, it's very difficult for people to even understand what you're talking about. Especially if you're making I've seen these, the sacred name Bibles and the Hebrew roots Bibles, and a lot of them have these Hebrew words added there. Well, the problem is that a lot of people are not going to know what that is. You know, it's going to be hard for them to understand. So, in terms of preaching to people the gospel, bringing them to the truth, you want to use their language. But you can tell them right off the bat. You could say, if you're uncomfortable saying Jesus, you could say, however you pronounce, like Yeshua or Yahushua. Yahushua, or as you pronounce, Jesus. Something like that, because otherwise it's just, there's going to be a disconnect. As Paul was saying, you know, he said he tried to be all things to all people. He did not mean, when he said that, he tried to be a sinner for people. You know, that's not what he was saying. He tried to reach them where they were. He tried to accommodate for them as best he could in all their situations. So that's how I understand it anyway. But I've talked about that long enough. And the Messiah was baptized. He had to be baptized, and I believe he was baptized. He was baptized by John the Baptist, and I think he probably was a priest, you know, because his father was a priest, and so very likely he was a priest too. Let me see here. There was something I missed, and I'm going to talk about that now. It was the cosmic geography thing, and that is divine beings ruling over certain regions of land. The Dead Sea Scrolls don't give too much information on that, but basically, Book of Enoch has a lot to say about it, and there's some fragments that talk about the sons of God having control over the nations, but I'm just going to go through from Enoch, because that's the most clear, and Enoch tells us that some of the angels were set as rulers over the nations, and their job was to oversee them, to rule them, and if any of them, their job was to destroy some of them who violated the commandments. They basically were to have a sovereign rule over these nations. But Enoch says, now, to another angel, or something, I think it was, mark what action these angels do, because I assure you, they're going to go above and beyond what they were commanded to do, and they're going to kill people who should not have been killed. So they're going to go beyond what was commanded of them, and they're going to, basically, it's going to be like a fall, it was going to be another fall of the Watchers. But not the Watchers falling, but it's going to be the princes of the nations. They're going to fall. They're going to violate their office that was commanded of them. That's what Enoch says in the dream vision section, where he has a dream of all of history, and he's told about that. So there was this division of the different nations. The nations each had their angelic ruler to rule over their territory, and this was appointed to them by the lot of God, the division that was given from him. And there were also demons as well, who basically if the Gentiles worshipped the demons or did various unclean things that opened themselves to these demons, then the demons had the right and authority and the justification, the legal righteousness to possess them. So that's a strong connection. The princes over the nations, and then there's also the demons over the nations as well, who they have the legal right and the righteousness of possessing those who who open themselves and deserve to be possessed. It's a way of punishing them. That's what these Dead Sea Scrolls are teaching us. The Book of Jubilees tells us that Noah, he was praying because his sons came to him and said, "We are getting attacked by demons. Please help us. Pray to God to save us from this." So he prayed. Noah prayed, and God heard him. And he's like, "Okay, I'm gonna do this for Noah because Noah's my guy. He's my friend. So I'm gonna help him. I'm gonna answer his prayer, and I'm gonna send away all these demons into the prison." As he was doing that, Satan comes along, or Mastema, as Jubilee says. Mastema is related to the same root word as Satan. The S-T, Satan, and Mastema. The S-T of Mastema and the S-T of Satan are the same two Hebrew letters. And that's not a coincidence because it's the same root. They just have slightly different extra changes. Just like in English, we have changes on the end or beginning of words to slightly change the meaning. That's what happened in Hebrew. So Mastema came to God and said, "Don't do this. Don't send away all the demons. You can't do this, because if you do this, then there's not going to be anyone here to punish and to harm and attack the sorry for the noise in the background. My apologies. There's not going to be anyone available to attack those who deserve it as punishment for their sins." And God basically said, "You're right. I'm not going to send them all away. I'm going to send 9/10 of them away. 10% I'm going to save, allow to remain, and they're going to be under your authority." So there is this concept of the angels were given authority over the nations, and they were to exercise the righteous rule over them, but they also had the ability to abuse their rule. And so they're going to be held to account for that on Judgment Day. They will be held account for the abuse of their power. And yeah, Daniel talks about this story in Daniel 10 of the prince that was fighting with Michael, and Michael needed help. So there is a lot about this in the scriptures. So I think I've addressed everything that people asked right now. Do you guys have anything else that was on your mind? Barbara, if you have anything, you can also you can type a question, or if you're curious about something, a topic you'd like me to teach on, please share in the typing box of Skype. And for those on the Meet Cheap conference thing we're doing, if you have a specific teaching you'd like me to do, then please share now. If you don't, then I'm going to be moving on to something else. I'll wait just a little bit to give you guys time. Let me see here. So far, it looks like no one else has anything on their mind. So, let me see. Yeah, that's a good question. So, you know, is there a way you guys can help with the Essene Bible that I'm working on? And are all the books in my current library? I have a website with my library, and I'm trying to, on my library site, I'm trying to do all literature. Not just scripture, but even secular writings. However, since I changed some of my beliefs very recently, as I told you guys last week in my study of the secret teachings, I decided I can't be sharing all these secret books with people. That was my original plan, was to make a Bible that had everything in it, all the secret scriptures, to publish it all. Now, a lot of that stuff is already available anyway, but I'm going to be, I have those on my site, but they are in the secret scriptures section, and it's password protected, so only if you had the password can you view all those files, and I'm not giving the password to people until they, go through the process. So all the secret scriptures are on my special site, but it's protected so that most people can't see it. But how you can help with the Essene Bible, that my project that I'm working on. Well, if you know certain languages, you can help with that. Like, so for instance, if you know Greek, if you know Latin, you can help teach me that. As I'm learning those languages, you can help me with that. That's a way to help. Another way to help is, I don't ask people, I don't make it a practice of asking people for money, for donations or anything. But if you feel led to, that's a way you can help too. You can help by, there are various resources that I can buy to further better this project. For instance, there's the Göttingen Septuagint. What that is a master edition of the Septuagint, but it costs a lot of money. So that's not, that's how do I put it? That would be really awesome to have and make it even better. It would make it even further to reinforce and to help us figure out all these things. But I already have so many resources that while that would be beneficial, it's not 100% necessary. But it would be a great resource to have to help with that project. But so money can help. But, as I said, I don't make a practice of asking people for money. My entire time doing this, only one person has donated. And they only donated a small amount, but for them, it might have been a lot. I valued what they were able to give me. It was very kind of them. And I never even asked about it. They just, out of nowhere, said they wanted to help me. So, and I have another friend who says he wants to help me, buy me some books sometime or something like that. So, there's different ways of helping out. But the best way to help out is spreading the cause of, if you believe in this project or in what I'm doing, tell other people about it. Tell them about what I'm doing. Share the word. Share some of these studies with people who are interested. It's a great way because it's just encouraging me. So I'm really encouraged when I see people interested in what I'm sharing. And I'd like people to know the truth of these lost scriptures and to have a true and accurate version of the Bible. So there's various ways you can help. And if you have an idea of I think I could probably help in this way, then let me know which way you're thinking, and I'll let you know, yeah, that could really help. Or maybe I would say, well, that's a good idea. However, I'm thinking I'm going to go in a different direction than what you're suggesting. So I'm open to all kinds of ways of advice, helpful advice, editing. You can help me edit it. So basically, when I do start doing a translation, you can start going through it and you can take the time to edit it, look at it and say, I see a typo here, or I see, problems. That would help. That's a great way to help, but this is going to be a long project and I'm not going to start doing my translation for a while. I'll probably be doing it sometime next year, because I'm trying to get certain things done before that time. I want to make sure I'm ready to dive into it. I want to start learning some of these languages a little bit better, stuff like that. So I'm not ready to fully dive into it yet. I've already done a lot of preliminary work though. So I have my goal set. I have various points in line of what I'm planning on, but I'm not going to go dive fully into it yet. But just keep being posted. Follow me, what I'm doing, and I'm going to be sharing and updating about my progress, and we'll see how it goes. Oh, and one other thing that could help, depending where you live, or if you know, even if you don't live in a certain place, but if you're willing to travel places, there are different libraries across the world which have certain books there. You can actually go to a library in your area or drive to a library which has a rare book that I would highly value and like to see. You can go and see that book, and then you could maybe scan it or something and send me it, some way to help me get that copy, a copy of that book, and that would really help for my project if there's a certain books which are not widely available. Because some books I'm trying to find, and they're nowhere available. I'm trying to buy them, and there's nowhere online that they're being sold. But they're in libraries in various places, so, you know, if you, that's a way to help, too. And yeah, there was the question of, what about the two books of the New Covenant? Yeah, I mentioned in one of the previous studies that I've done of, in the New Testament of the Ethiopian Bible, they have 8 extra books, and 2 of those books they called the 2 books of the covenant. And it's talking about the New Covenant. And basically, you know, as I said, those are a part of the Ethiopian Bible. They're canonical, but they are secret scriptures. But they're very good. They teach about, first, it's like prophecies about the future, like last days, and then there's also, I think there's the letter the apostles write, telling them about theology, various things they need to know. But then there's also, part of that is, the Messiah teaching the apostles how to do the priesthood, certain things about the priesthood. So it talks about like certain rituals to be done, things like that, for the various congregations or the churches, you know. That's what those books are about, basically. There's a lot of depth in them, a lot of good stuff I find in those writings. I mean, in the future we can go through and study some of those together through these teachings that I do, these studies. But I'm trying to think of the best way to do it, because with those writings, they're supposed to be even more secret than all the others. The apostles, the law of the apostles, and the Clement writings, those are very secret compared to most of the others. There's a lot more warnings about those books than other books being shared. So I can kind of discuss some of that information, but I have to be more, I'm not sure how much I can quote, things like that. So I'll just kind of be, I'll share what I am comfortable sharing based on my understanding of what I'm allowed to share from these writings, if, you know, on future studies, if you guys are interested in hearing some of what these books, say. Let's see here. So I think that's it for what people have been saying. Let's see what time we have right now. We've been doing this for about an hour and 10 minutes. We will be going for at least 20 more minutes. We might be going for about 40 more minutes, possibly. Yeah. Brenton, the Brenton Septuagint, that contains, it doesn't have most of the Apocrypha, is not in there. Oh, and let me tell you, I posted this on Facebook, but I'm just going to tell you guys right now, the books that I'll be including in my version of the Bible that's going to be public for everybody. So let me load that right now. Let's see here. There's going to be 62, is it 62? Yeah. I think it's 62 books that I'll be including in my translation. And those are... Let's see here. Hold on one sec. My internet's slightly slow, but... Okay. So we've got there's other versions of the Septuagint. I was looking for the Göttingen Septuagint. That is a special series for the Septuagint, which there's like a bunch of volumes, and it costs a lot of money for each. Each individual book is probably like a couple hundred dollars. If you want a PDF version of all that, it's something like $700. It's not even PDF. I think it's just an online module or something. It's an online version that you can view in the special program for like $700. And there's a book version which would be much more expensive, like $3,000 or $4,000. So yeah, it's a very it'd be good resources, but super expensive. So I'm not really aiming for that because that's unrealistic from my abilities. Over the years, I've spent tons of money. Most of my money over the years that I had is spent in books. And the land that I got, I paid $5,350 for the land that I bought. That's 40 acres of land, and then a lot of my money I spent on books. I've probably spent about something like $4,000 on books over the years. And when I say I spent that, my parents gave me a lot of that. They gave me sometimes gifts, like gift money. But a lot of that, perhaps 3,000 of that is my own that I've spent from when I had a job a few years ago. So I'm very much focused on, you know, all the money I get, I use for my, I don't use it to buy pretty much anything fun for myself, because I don't need it. I like doing free stuff, and well, you know, there's internet right here, so free music online, free videos, you know, all this stuff, so I don't really see the need to unnecessarily buy stuff. That's like a waste of money. I only get a little bit of money as gift money every year. I should use it wisely and righteously, and I'm going to use it for this project that I have. That's what I do. This coming year, my parents are going to be giving me a little bit more money, maybe $150, maybe $200, I don't know, something like that. I already have some books in mind. I'm going to be getting more books about the Dead Sea Scrolls. When we get one about the Acts of Paul, that's going to be a really awesome one. That's what I'm really looking forward to. So, I already have stuff planned for more books that I'm planning on getting. Certain books that are supposed to be coming out, I will be getting once they come out. But the people who are publishing them, they're being like super slow about it. So I've been waiting for years for some of these, and they keep on delaying when they're gonna be sharing it. So I'm still waiting for another, like I'm waiting for at least three different volumes that are supposed to be coming out of special books that are four that are coming out, and I have no clue when they're gonna be coming out. I only one of them I know is probably coming out next fall. Is their projected date, but they often push it back farther, so I have no clue. I mean, but these are important to me. They'll be important books to get, but I'm gonna just have to wait until they come out, and then once they come out, I'm gonna buy those. So there's definitely some great stuff that over the years they found some new Dead Sea Scrolls. I mean, they were already found, but they were able to acquire them and purchase them. And there's a new book that's coming out. It's going to be coming out maybe, I think it's next year. and it's a new publication, I'd love to have that. That's going to be, though, like, let me quickly check right now how much that is. Let's see here. So, you know, I mean, if someone feels led to, they can help me out in that sense. Or they can get it themselves and take and show me pictures of it, at least. I don't necessarily have to have a copy of it, but I'd love to have access to what it says in there. So it is a, let me find it here. It's in my, I posted the link in my group. Hold on 1 second. Or I should say 1 minute. Okay, there it is. So opening that link now. And so this costs, this is going to be released April 7th, 2016. It's called Gleanings from the Caves, Dead Sea Scrolls and Artifacts from the Cheyenne Collection. And they're charging a pre-order price of $140. $140. And all it is the special edition publishes 10 biblical and 5 non-biblical fragments from the Judean desert. More than half of them for the first time. Fragments will be published with 42 adjoining photographs. And it'll be colored as well. And the publication of 7 new fragments will be there. Update scholars on the full textual situation. So it would be definitely something that would be valuable to buy. So I hope to get that around my birthday. That's around my birthday, so I'm probably gonna ask my parents, can you get that for me? I'd love to have this, or something like that. Unless someone else would be willing to get it for me, I'd like to have that. So these are the books that I'm gonna be putting in my version of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, and Numbers, but I'm going to be using the Dead Sea Scrolls as the chief. Pretty much the Dead Sea Scrolls is the chief for everything I'll be using, okay? So that's what it's going to start with, and then there's the Temple Scroll. That's going to be the fifth book of the law. I won't be doing Deuteronomy. I'll do my own version of my special reconstructed version of Deuteronomy based on the Temple Scroll idea. Then it's going to be Joshua, Judges, Ruth. Then I'm going to do, after that, it'll be 1st and 2nd Samuel. And then Tobit will come after that. Then 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles. And then it's coming next, 1st Esdras, not Ezra and Nehemiah. I'm not doing Ezra and Nehemiah. I accept 1st Esdras, not Ezra and Nehemiah. And My understanding of First Esdras is that we're missing parts of it, so I'm gonna have to try to reconstruct the missing part too as best I can. So that'll be next, First Esdras. Then will come Esther, the Septuagint version. Then Judith will come next, Book of Judith. Following that will be Third Maccabees, then Second Maccabees, then First Maccabees. Then will be the Psalm Scroll. It's a special version of the Book of Psalms found in the Temple Scroll. My understanding is the original Book of Psalms was very different based on the scrolls that were found. So I'm going to be making that special version of the Psalms from that concept. After that will be the Song of Songs, then Lamentations, then there'll be the Book of Job, then the Book of Wisdom, or the Wisdom of Solomon. Proverbs will come next. Ecclesiastes, then Wisdom of Sirach, That'll be next. Then it's the 12 prophets. Sorry about the noise in the background again. So the book of the 12 prophets, in a slightly different order. Then there'll be Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. And then for the New Testament, so that was for the Old Testament, okay? For the New Testament, it's going to be, let's see here. Okay, you're back in. Good to have you back in. All right. Hold on 1 second. I'm just going to see what's going on. Sorry, guys. Lots of noise in the background with the dog, but my apologies. So for the New Testament, there's going to be Mark, Matthew, Luke, John. Then it'll be the letters of Paul, slightly different order, but you know, it's going to include the letter of Laodiceans as well. After all of Paul's letters, it's going to be James, Jude, 1 Peter, 2 Peter, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. Then it'll be 1 Clement, 2 Clement. Then it'll be Hebrews, Epistle of Barnabas, Shepherd of Hermas, and the Book of Acts. I will not be including the Revelation, even though I consider it scripture. I'm not going to be including Revelation in my version of the Bible. The one I'm doing, it's because I feel like, as I said in the last week's teaching, I said about the secret scriptures concept. And in my personal belief, based on last week's teaching that I did, is that Revelation is scripture, but it's one of those secret scriptures. So that I'm not including that in my public version. But so Lynette has come. We have been doing this for about an hour and 20 minutes. We'll probably be doing this for at least another 20 minutes. If you have any questions you'd like to ask, please feel free to do that. That's what this study is about, where basically people will ask questions about any topic related to the scriptures, and I answer them from the perspective of the Dead Sea Scroll faith, just to give you another alternative to see for yourself. You know, maybe the Essenes or the Dead Sea Scrolls has some truth that I don't have yet. And so this is for you to see what the other side is saying, because most people are sharing what the Pharisee side teaches, and people don't really get that Essene perspective from the ancient times. So that's what all this is about, giving people that chance. And I just told people the version of the Bible that I'm going to be, I have a huge project, the Essene Jewish Bible Project, and I'm not going to be including all the scriptures in there. I'm going to be including the books that I believe I'm allowed to share with everybody, and these are 62 books. They're the Old and New Testament, as well as a few other books as well that I'll be sharing with people. Those are the books that I'll be including, guys. So do any of you have any other questions on your mind or things you'd like me to teach on? Again, I'll be probably doing this for about 20 minutes more, maybe 40 minutes more, depending if you guys are interested, or if we're deep in a topic, then I'll keep going. But otherwise, it's going to be about 20 more minutes. Have anything else? We'll wait just a minute. Yeah. That's a good question. You know, in the Dead Sea Scrolls, there's not any specific, you know, like they don't talk about birthdays, but they do talk about the various holy days that they believe are required. And one of the things that's required is some people believe that the season days are pagan holidays, like, because some of the pagans actually celebrate the change of the season, like the spring equinox, the fall equinox, the summer and winter solstices. Those are actually sometimes holy days in pagan groups. But according to the Dead Sea Scrolls in the Book of Jubilees, that's also truly holy days that we are also required to keep it as special Sabbath days, the new moon days. But according to the Dead Sea Scrolls and Jubilees, it would not be new moon, it'd be new month days. And so those, there's four of those every year. So there's a thing of, is this pagan? Because pagans do it? Not necessarily. Pagans can do something, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it's pagan. So in regards to birthdays, here's what we have. We have, in the scriptures, we have people marking how old they are. That's only possible if you're acknowledging the day of birth as a marker for how old you are. Like, you know, it says for, you know, so-and-so person died at this number of years old. That's only possible to know if you're marking their day of birth and saying, okay, now he's this number of years old. So they were marking their days, what day of birth they had. So we have that. And then they also have, let's see here. I think a lot about birthdays is pagan most of the time, because people do bad stuff on those days. Like, they party, they go out drinking, they do all kinds of stuff, and, you know, with evil people. We should not be partying with the wicked. We should not be partying with unsaved people, or unbelievers anyway. We shouldn't be partying with unbelievers. We shouldn't be doing all these things with unbelievers. So you can celebrate your life. You can thank God for giving you your birth. But don't make it something that's a vanity festival. Don't make it something worshiping yourself and how awesome you are. It's something that if you do it in the right way, I think it can be fine. Now Josephus, though, in Josephus' mind, he was not an Essene, but according to Josephus, he said birthdays are pagan. Or, you know, he didn't say those words, but he said, we don't keep birthdays because that's what the heathen do, or something like that. But from my perspective, that is not totally true. I mean, in the Book of Jubilees, we see that, I think it was Isaac. Yeah, Isaac. Isaac's birth was on one of the holy days of the old covenant and of the law of Moses, and I forget if it was already a festival or it was made into a festival. Basically, in the Book of Jubilees, the various patriarchs make the festivals. So Shavuot, that was made by Noah. He made that. And Abraham, he made the Feast of Tabernacles, and he made the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Jacob made the eighth day after Tabernacles. Jacob made the Day of Atonement. Moses made Passover. All these people were making new days. And so, if I remember correctly, a new day was made on the day of birth of Isaac. And it was a holy day. It's a holy day now. So, you know, there's something like that, which is a strong connection of Isaac's birth to Holy Day. But then there's also in the New Testament secret scriptures, the Apocrypha, in the Ethiopian Bible, we have, looks like we lost Lynette. In the Ethiopian Bible, we have certain books which tell us that the Messiah's day of birth is a holy day. We should be honoring that day. Now, let's think of this for a second. If a Catholic was to write it, what day do you think they would have picked? they probably would have picked December 25th, right? 10/25. But that's not the day that these books say. The day that these books say that he was born on is the 25th of the 9th month. And do you realize what the significance of that is? The 25th of the 9th month, that is Hanukkah. That's the first day of Hanukkah. According to the books of Maccabees, Hanukkah begins on the 25th of the 9th month. So, it seems to me that the original thing was 25th of the 9th month. And then, remember, things got switched. The calendar was getting switched around. You've got, the question is, should the first month be March or April? Well, the problem is, the beginning of spring is like in the middle. It's like near the end of March and near the beginning of April. It's not quite at the beginning of April, but it's actually closer to the beginning of April than it is to March. And so, these churches decided, let's go with, what did they decide? They decided to go with, March as their beginning. And then they had to switch, from a 9, they switched it to 10. So it resulted in a shift from all the dates. So my thoughts are is that, you know, if this writing in the Catholic, or excuse me, not the Catholic, in the Ethiopian Bible, if it was made by a Catholic, they would have said December 25th. But the fact that they said Hanukkah, the first day of Hanukkah, to me suggests that whoever wrote this, which I believe the apostles did, but even if it wasn't the apostles, it seems like it has to be like written by some Jewish group of believers, because why would they pick Hanukkah? That is not anywhere in the church history or tradition, and yet it's right there in these books. So that's just something very interesting to me. But according to these books, his day of birth is a holy day we should be honoring as well. So for me, the concept of a birthday is not pagan. And then you got things like Easter and Christmas. There's certain things about that which there's probably some pagan features to it. I don't know everything about those days, what exactly makes them pagan. I do know, you know, Book of Jeremiah speaks about be careful, you know, talks about the tree thing. So I try to be careful of that. But there are certain things about those days that aren't necessarily pagan, even though they're being done on those days, like giving people gifts. People can give each other gifts on any day of the year. There's nothing wrong with giving your kids gifts around that same time. Things like that, you know. So you have to try to use your mind of don't go overboard in labeling something pagan. There are definitely pagan things and customs that we want to watch out for. I don't participate in all those festivities. I don't make a big deal about Thanksgiving, but, you know, it's okay to be thankful on Thanksgiving Day. It's okay. But you know, I don't make much special about it. I don't do anything really for Halloween. That's kind of completely ridiculous. But you know, there's other things where you can do some good things on those days. You shouldn't try to follow the customs, the traditions. You don't need to do traditions that if you don't even know what the traditions mean, why do them? It's not a good idea to do traditions unless you know for sure the meaning of it, the significance of it, and then you're okay with the origin of those, of the traditions. So, I also find Mother's Day and Father's Day to be very silly. You know, but my family does it. I'm not gonna say they're necessarily evil for doing it, but to me it's very silly, and I'm not going to be really doing that with my kids or my family. But I wouldn't say that it's really pagan. Mother's Day, Father's Day, it's a day to honor your parents. You know, we should be honoring our parents every day. But if you want to honor your parents on a day, that's okay. I mean, maybe that's what Paul is talking about in the, you know, he talks about some people hold some days in esteem, some keep every day in esteem. Well, for example, Mother's Day and Father's Day. Some people keep a special Mother's and Father's Day where they're supposed to, you know, specially honor their mother and father that day. Well, some people do that every day. They honor their parents like that every day. Well, you know, it's okay as long as you're honoring your parents as they deserve. It's okay, even if you're, you know, that's how I take it. The Essenes, the Dead Sea Scrolls, they haven't written on every topic. Even if they have, we don't have all of their writings. We only have some of them. So some of it's guesswork. But as I said, I believe the apostles were Essenes. So I use the apostles to help understand the correct teachings of what the Essenes believed. And because they taught the Messiah's day is something we should be honoring, that's why I teach it as well. All right, thank you for joining. We'll be finishing soon after you leave, so you won't miss too much more, but I appreciate you coming, and I hope you enjoyed what we have to share. Hopefully next week will be better. Shalom to you. Now, the question was asked by Laura. She said, what book it was that I was referring to? That was in... that is in the Teachings of the Apostles. In the Ethiopian Bible, they call it Didascalia, Ethiopic Didascalia. It gives basically holy days connected to the Messiah. Because here's the basic concept I'll be sharing with you guys. Is how did the holy days in the Old Testament come about? Jubilees tells us how. And it was through a holy process of, it didn't just come on Moses' day, and it didn't just all come at the beginning either. It was gradual. Whenever something holy happened, whenever something important happened, set apart, a new thing was set apart as holy. A new day, that is. And so, the Shavuot, how did that become holy? We're told in Jubilees it was because of what God did on that day with Noah, a special covenant on that day, binding. Same thing with the tabernacles, the unleavened bread, the Day of Atonement, the eighth day, Passover, all those days, what made them holy? Because God did something holy on that day. God did something set apart on that day. That's why the Sabbath was made holy. Because God did something set apart on that day. And he set apart that day by doing something special on that. So, in the same way, the apostles tell us in their writings and in these books, Messiah did some really holy stuff. And because he did that, it makes those days holy. It's the same principle in the book of Jubilees. And that's what the apostles are teaching. They say, these are new holy days. We all have to honor. And they give some of those holy days. And they give the dates of those days. And so, for the day of birth, they give the 25th of the ninth month. Now, some people in recent times have been stating that he was born at the Feast of Tabernacles. Right here, though, the comment was saying he was born in spring. But then you say September. You know, if he's born in spring, it can't be September. Because September is in fall. So maybe you mean conceived in spring. Possibly. But so, you know, a lot of people use a reasoning ability. They say, okay, well, you know, tabernacles would be a fitting time for him to be born in. And then they use other reasoning to come to that conclusion. I think that makes a lot of assumptions. And one of the assumptions made is... he just said that he meant fall, not spring. It was a mistake. One of the main reasonings that people use is the priestly cycle. But you'll actually find that the priestly cycle argument people are using is not in line with what the Dead Sea Scrolls says about the priestly cycle. There are some differences. So basically, what is it? The priestly order, it tells us, I think it was in the course of Abijah, I think it was, in the New Testament, that's what we're told. When someone was conceived, I think it was a cousin, John the Baptist, when he was conceived, it was during the Abijah cycle. The problem is, according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, that cycle could be at any time of the year, because it changes. Every year, it's changing what time of the year it is. Their calendar writings tell us, in this year it's going to be at this time, in this year it's going to be at another time. So it's changing, and so you can't look at the New Testament and say, if the Dead Sea Scrolls are correct, that is, you can't look at the New Testament and say, oh look, it says he was born at the time of Abijah, that must mean the Messiah was born during Tabernacles. So I find that a faulty argument because of the Dead Sea Scrolls teaching differently about the priestly cycle. But Hanukkah, on the other hand, that's also like a Tabernacles, because in the Maccabees books we're told that that is a second Tabernacles date. And then the apostles, that's what they tell us. I believe the apostles said those words, so I trust what they said. If people don't accept those words as the apostles, or they're not sure those were the apostles' words, then it's valid to, you know, if you're not sure they said that, then you can't be certain about it. But if you have the faith that they said that, then you can accept that. And that's, for me, that's what I do. I accept that was the day. And when does that happen? According to the Enoch and Dead Sea Scroll calendar, that 25th of the ninth day, the Hanukkah thing, that comes around, it's like December 9th, somewhere around there. It's around that time. It's like a couple, maybe 3 weeks, not 3 weeks, two, maybe more like 2 weeks prior to the regular Christmas that these different groups do. And then there's the other churches, they have it as the 25th as well, but their calendar is different. I think it's on, because it's on the Julian. So they do it at the 6th, January 6th, not December 25th. So there's some differences in how they're doing the day of birth. But remember, there's a day of birth that has to be separate from all the other stuff part of Christmas. Santa has nothing to do with his birth. Has nothing, to, you know. His day of birth does not have to do with giving people presents, and putting up Christmas trees and all those cultural things. So we want to disassociate from those things, and we want to say, when is his day of birth? And let's try to honor his day of birth. You know, I think that's fine to do. But let's not do all that other stuff. Let's not do Christmas trees. Let's not do, you know. But you can give people gifts if you want. There's nothing wrong with that. But don't do the Santa thing. That's ridiculous. You know, Santa stuff is stupid. So don't do stuff like that. Especially because it's lying to your kids too. And it's just ridiculous stuff. You know. So hopefully that answers that question. I mean, it's a controversial issue. A lot of people have difficulty with these topics because it's very close to home, and a lot of people have clashes with their family members about these stuff. But I feel like sometimes people go overboard and condemn things as pagan when they shouldn't, and other times people go way underboard and say, "Oh, it's okay, it'll be fine." So we shouldn't go to either extremes. We should try to find a middle ground, and try to be loving to our neighbor. So hopefully that helps answer the question. So we've been here about 1 hour and 45 minutes. Do you guys have any final things you'd like me to share about, or how are you guys right now? Are you pretty much ready for the end of the teaching to be now, or do you want me to go like 10 more minutes or something? I'll try to go based on what you guys say. Laura wants you to go 10 more. What about you other guys? You want me to go like 10 more minutes? Alright, I'll go 10 more minutes. And if you guys have to leave at any time, just, you know, this is being recorded again, so. So what can I say in 10 minutes? Basically, I really recommend studying the Dead Sea Scrolls yourself. There's so much depth in them. Genesis Apocryphon, that's amazing. It's one of the key texts there. Book of Enoch, Book of Jubilees, I highly recommend those. Those are like, to me, those are foundational texts for the faith. Temple Scroll, you want to study the Temple Scroll. And you want to study the Psalms Scroll. Those are some amazing ones. So in the future, we can go through and study together those things. Now, while I have the rest of this time with you guys, can you, John, remember, you were here the other week. We did the study. And the other week when we did that study, we went through the book of Proverbs. And you said that was, you enjoyed it. However, you said you find it more important or more relevant for your faith to go through some other book, like a more like a prophet book or something else that is more powerful, or, you know, other differences which are more compelling. Would you like to share now of the books of the Old Testament? Are there certain books which you would like a lot if we were to focus on that? Share with me, like, if you want me to go through another book like that, the next study, next study we do together, let me know now. You can let me know now, and we'll do that next week. So, do you have a book in mind that you would like me to go through the differences? The main differences. I wouldn't go through all of them, but tell me if you want. But so let's see. Are there any trustworthy translations? You have the Hallelujah Scriptures, Apocrypha, and Het Sefer. Any other suggestions? Well, it's okay to have those. But basically, I don't really. English translations are really questionable at best. They're almost all based on the Masoretic text, and I have a major problem with that. So I would advise going with Renton's Septuagint, the one that was mentioned before by you. That one, I think, is one of the most important ones. Go with that one, primarily. Renton is great. There's Orthodox Study Bible. That's an interesting one. That's a good one. That's also from the Septuagint, and it includes the New Testament as well. So, and it has some interesting study notes. So, Orthodox Study Bible, I recommend that one. And, yeah, I mean, those are the main ones I would probably recommend. So, I'm going to be doing translations in the future, as I said, and they'll be much better. You'll have much greater depth. Based on the Dead Sea Scrolls, based on the Septuagint, it'll indicate differences from the Masoretic text. You know, it'll be all that stuff. It'll be really good information. For the Ethiopian, there is not an English translation of the Ethiopian yet. There are a couple books that have been translated, but otherwise, none of it. But we do have translation of it in, I mean, it's not translation, but we have the actual the copies in Ethiopian. I have the PDF files of most of the Ethiopian books of the Old Testament and New Testament, so if someone knows Ethiopian, they can help me translate that. I don't know Ethiopian, and that's a really difficult language to learn. And that's going to be not a... the Ethiopian's not going to be a major concern for me. If I can learn it, that'd be awesome. But it's not so much important compared to all the other versions. In terms of the regular books of the Bible, that is. But in terms of books of that are only in Ethiopian, like Enoch, then it becomes much more important. And Jubilees. So Brenton's, that's only the Old Testament, because the Septuagint was only the Old Testament. The New Testament is not part of the Septuagint. Brenton did his translation of the Septuagint. So I recommend Brenton's for the Septuagint Old Testament. If you want the Septuagint, but you also want a New Testament in one, I recommend the Orthodox Study Bible. That's great. Their New Testament is just a reprint of the New King James Version. And it gives footnotes telling you about the NU text, differences in the NU text, which is the scholarly edition of the New Testament that most translations use now. Those are the, I would recommend those translations. Nothing else I really know. I mean, the Et Sefer is a, how do I put it lightly? It's a ripoff in the sense that all they did, from my perspective anyway, all they did was copy other people's work, put it together, and then sell it as their own. Alleluia scriptures, my understanding of what they did was they mainly took an English translation already of the Old Testament based on the Masoretic text, and then they added Hebraic version to their names, and then they changed some of the words to be more Hebraic, or they believed certain words were pagan, so anytime they found a word like that, they removed it and replaced it with a word that they thought was better. Other than that, I really don't see anything special about the Alleluia scriptures. Oh, and they also have his divine name inserted into it. And yeah, the Et Sefer has the Aleph Tav added in. In my view, though, the Aleph Tav thing is completely silly. I do believe that, you know, Messiah was beginning and the end, the Aleph and the Tav. I don't believe he's the Aleph Tav letter or word. I think that's a misunderstanding that a lot of people are teaching now. So in my Bible, you're not going to see anything special about the Aleph Tav. All you're going to see is, I'm going to make a little symbol. I'll show you. It's going to be a colon. So it'll be like in the first sentence of Genesis, you're going to see, it says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There's actually two Aleph Tavs in that first verse of Genesis 1:1. So it's, in the beginning, created Elohim at the heavens and at the earth. You'll see something like this in my Bible. You will not see Aleph Tav. You will see something like a colon. And that's basically to tell you it's a sign. And all it's telling you is it's connecting the verb to the subject. Okay? So, in the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and created the earth. You see, you have to repeat that twice. But instead of repeating it twice in Hebrew, all you have to say is Elohim created the heavens and the earth, and you use those two marks just to mark that both of those nouns are being created. Okay, that's what you do. Aleph Tav is in the Dead Sea Scrolls. It's a key grammar issue. It's a grammar issue. It almost has never anything to do with the Messiah. It is specifically part of the grammar markings, and it's only when it's only a definite article. So, you know, when you're saying the, okay, and it's an object, when it's an object and when it's the, it is going to have that aleph tav there. So, in the beginning, God created aleph tav. That's going to tell you, okay, the next noun that's coming, that's what he's creating. The heavens, alright? So we know he created the heavens. And, alright, is this a new sentence? Is this a new sentence? Is this going to be something else? But wait. And aleph tav. Oh, okay. That means that the verb created is also going to be applied to something else. What's it being applied to? And the earth. Oh, okay. So, and marking towards the earth. So that means he's creating the heavens and the earth. In English, we don't need to do that. We because it's understood by context. In Hebrew, it's not understood by context. You need that marker there. Otherwise, you don't know what they're saying. Some Hebrew people will tell you that's not true, but that's incorrect. In the ancient Hebrew, anyway, you need those markers. Those are key, because without those markers, your words could have a very different meaning. Without the aleph tav, it basically could mean, in the beginning, God, or in the beginning, the God of heaven, of the heavens and the earth created. That's what it could mean. Without the aleph tav, that's what it could mean. You could translate it like that. I think, if I remember correctly. There might be one thing in there that you can't do that. Actually, it might be, it might be something like, in the beginning, the God of the heavens created, and then you have to set it apart as a different clause, and the earth. Or it could even be understood as meaning the heavenly gods, something like that, you know. So it basically, you need those aleph tav there to make sure the sentence is grammatical and makes sense. Because without those aleph tavs, it doesn't make sense. It sounds like nonsense. So it's not about the Messiah. So, you know, if you get the aleph tav, if you get the Et Sefer Bible, in my opinion, they spent a whole amount of time wasting their time telling you about the aleph tav. That's completely useless. It's not really about the Messiah at all. All it is just a marker to help you with grammar. Like in English, you know, you're going to see, you're going to see of a lot. Of. That tells us, what does it tell us? That's a word that tells us possession. It belongs to something. So, son of God, that means God's son, right? So, the of tells us a special grammar power. It tells us belonging to something. In the same way, aleph tav just simply is a grammar similar to of, and it tells us, it just tells us about the object. It tells us where the verb is being addressed to, what the verb is applying to. You know, if you are going to be, if you're going to be, like, let's say, the man, went to the mall and killed the woman, that sentence right there, the Aleph Tav. I'm pretty sure you need the Aleph Tav there, but perhaps I'm forgetting and you don't need it in this instance, but I think you need it in this instance. And you'd basically say that the Aleph Tav is direct, like, who did he kill? You need to have the Aleph Tav to tell you, oh, okay, he killed the woman. Because without the Aleph Tav, then it makes it sound like the woman killed someone. So if we were saying the man went to the mall and killed the woman in a secret room, we know what that's saying in English, but in Hebrew it could mean the man went to the mall and the woman killed in a secret room. So you see, you need the Aleph Tav there to help tell you who is the object, what is the object. But then, of course, we do have the additional thing in Hebrew of the gender distinction. So most of the time, like, a woman is going to be feminine, and the verb has to be feminine too. So it would be, if a man is killing, it would be killed with a masculine verb. But if a woman was doing the killing, it would be a woman with the feminine, should be killed with the feminine verb. So I know that was a horrible example to use of killing. That's the first thing that came into my head. Don't worry, I'm not going to kill anybody. I'm not a killer. I'm a lover, not a fighter. Don't worry. What were you saying, Josh? The Et Sefer, yeah, they included a lot of books in there. So that's a plus to see all the books there. But otherwise, I think they waste a lot of time going through and putting in the Et. To me, it doesn't make sense. I understand the concept is based on Revelation, but I think it's it's like an abuse. It's going way too far from what he's saying. It's like, when the gospel says, behold the Lamb of God, talking about Yeshua, the Lamb of God. It'd be like them going through every part in the Old Testament and saying, oh, look, the word Lamb. We got to put that there because that's the Messiah. Well, no. Not every instance a lamb is mentioned in Scripture. It's the Messiah. He was just using an example in that one instance to convey a character of the Messiah. He is like a lamb. He's a lamb of God because, you know, like a sacrificial lamb. Similarly, when he said he's the beginning and the end, the Aleph and Tav, he was just using that as an example to convey he everything is part of him. Everything is included in his essence. He's not saying every time you see Aleph Tav, that's the Messiah. That's an abuse of the point. Anyways, you know, a lot of people who hear that, they're not going to accept that. They're going to find that, like, because it doesn't agree with what they believe. They really think that this is something special, that this is indicating that this is a messianic prophecy. Whenever you see Aleph Tav, it's a messianic prophecy. That's completely silly, from my understanding of the language. That's not valid. So, anyways, that's all I have today. We've gone over the 2-hour mark, so I'm going to end it here. Any final thoughts? Otherwise, I'm ending it now. I very much appreciate you guys coming again, and I hope you stay tuned next week. I have to tell you guys one thing. So while I'm telling you this, if you really want to know one final thing, just ask and I'll answer it. But otherwise, I'm ending it now. And so Jackson, Snyder, and me, we are going to begin a special thing. We've been talking recently. He talked to me yesterday. We're going to be doing a debate. it's going to be not just once, we're going to be doing it over several weeks, and it's probably going to do it once every 2 weeks, and I don't know how many times we're going to do it, but we're going to cover several issues. The first issue we're going to start with is Paul. We're going to debate the Apostle Paul. I don't know what the debate is going to be about yet. It's probably going to be me defending Paul as an apostle. Paul is an apostle, I believe. And then Jackson might be defending the viewpoint that he's not an apostle. But I'm going to talk with him and see exactly what we're going to be doing. But I think you guys will find that very interesting. I'm going to be defending the Apostle Paul in a debate with Jackson Snyder. So we will give you guys the information on that once we set it up. Probably going to be an hour and a half long. And he has a lot of interesting ideas. We, Jackson Snyder and I, have a partnership, and we have a lot of differences, but he respects my work, and he believes in my work, and he tries to help other people. He tries to share some of my ideas with them. So, I have a lot of respect, and he's my friend, but we do disagree on a lot of things. So, I can't ignore the things that I believe are important just because of a friendship. But I'm also going to be a good friend to him, and we'll discuss in peace together and hopefully come to some cool agreements. And there's so much more that we're going to have with people. So it'll be exciting, I think. So that's what we're going to be – we're planning that soon. So we'll make an announcement on Facebook within the next couple of days probably. I just wanted to tell you guys about that. Anyways, that'll be coming soon. All right. I appreciate it all. I appreciate you guys attending. And I hope to see you next week. I don't know if we're going to be doing it next Sunday. I'll let you guys know on Facebook, okay? All right, shalom, and Yah bless you all.